Happy Sabbath, church family. Let's try again. Happy Sabbath, church family. Psalms 122, verse 1. I rejoiced, or I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Let's begin our service today in the singing of praises to Him and singing of hymns. And our first hymn today, hymn number 538, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Isn't it? I'm reminded of a guide. I think of tour guides. And a guide is someone who usually knows the place or where you're going very well, the ins and outs. And isn't it beautiful to know that God, Jehovah, is our guide through the journey of life? Let's continue singing our next song, Savior Like a Shepherd.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, Darwin Church. Happy Sabbath, Malak Church. And again, happy Sabbath to the best church in Darwin, Palmerston Church. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'd like to welcome you all to our divine service here at Darwin Seventh-day Adventist Church this morning. It is a privilege that we can all come together as a church family, as a church community, and sing praises and also worship together as a church family. If you're visiting today, please put your hands up. We have a lot of visitors. Hey, a lot of visitors today. Welcome to each visitors who are visiting us today. From wherever you have come from, we hope that you feel welcome here at Darwin Church, and we hope that this is not the first time you visit, but we pray that you'll visit every week for the rest of the year. So a special welcome to all our visitors. Special welcome to our Malak Church, our Palmerston Church, and our Darwin Church members. We thank you again for being here, and we welcome you also today to our divine service. We also welcome our speaker for the day, Pastor Darren Slade, who is visiting us from the conference office, our conference president. We welcome you too, Pastor Darren, and we are blessed to have you here and that you've had safe travels and that you're able to share God's word with us this morning. The announcements are on the board, as you see, and in the bulletin. The words of welcome is at the door, and to whoever comes in, then welcome, and we pray that you all have a blessed service and a blessed Sabbath. It's time for our offering. We take two offerings here in Darwin Church. Our first offering is our local building offering. This is not your main tithes and offering. This is the local offering. So give as the Lord leads.
Deacons are lifting our offering. The 250, 230 program that we will be having at Bachelor this afternoon. I invite each and every one of you, if you are free this afternoon at 2:30, please come over and join us in Bachelor. As we have already also announced last Sabbath about our sacrificial offering, If you don't have your money here with you, please just write us a note and put it in the offering bag. We will be so delighted to receive that from you as well as our sacrificial offering this week. Thank you.
Delay. I want to delay the children's story for a minute. I'd like to ask Mitty and Sarima to come up, please. Children don't mind being up here close anyway. But we're going to start. I'm just getting in before the children. How many of you recognize these two here? Have we seen them for a long time? I'm just going to find out how many years. How long have you been here?
8 years.
Only 8 years. That's all. What about you, Mitty?
6 years.
Six.
We're heading down to Queensland, Brisbane. Yes. We're leaving on Friday.
So
this is our last Sabbath, yes.
Well, I'm glad we caught you. I'm just glad we caught you before you left. We have a gift that we would like to give to them, something for them to remember the Darwin Church by. And there's a card at the door, if any of you would like to make sure and sign that card. We're going to miss you. I've enjoyed working with them and having them as friends here in the church. I'd like us just to bow our heads and pray for them before they go. Our dear Father in heaven, we thank you for all of those that have been part of Darwin Church and for this lovely couple here that are now going to leave us. I trust that you're in charge, and we thank you for that, even though we're going to miss them. And we thank you that for all that you've done for each one of us. Give them safe traveling, blessings, and we look forward to seeing them again, if not here on earth, in your kingdom. We ask and thank thee in thy name. Amen. Amen.
Right, on behalf of our family, we want just to say, well, we thank God for the family we have here. And we've had the best support over the past 8 years. And first of all, I'm going to miss my kids, the Pathfinders. And parents, I just, you know, I'm always up here telling you about Pathfinders. But my last bit again before I leave is I ask you to fully support the Pathfinder Club. They need you. They need your prayers. It's not easy being a Pathfinder leader. And you know, your kids are awesome. But let me tell you, Pathfinders is the best place for them to be in. Not only do they grow stronger physically, mentally, but most of all, spiritually. You know, they go to school 5 days a week. So I encourage you. We only ask 1 weekend of every 3 weeks. 5 hours, all we ask. And parents, please make time, support the Pathfinder Club. And we will miss you guys, and I hope that you continue to pray for us. So thank you, family.
Thank you very much. Now we'll ask the children to continue to come up for your story. Thanks.
We have so many kids, they're lining up the middle of the corridor. Isn't that amazing? What a blessing. All right, guys, I want to tell you a story today about protection. What do you use for protection? If you needed to protect yourself, what would you use? Muscles. What else? What else would you use? Your skills? What else would you use? A what? Would you use a sword? Like in the olden days, they used to use a sword to protect themselves. Armor. You would put armor on? What else? Anything else? A shield. Yes, well done. Yes, what else? Oh, a hammer? Thor's hammer. Oh, God's armor. It's way better than Thor's hammer. Well done. Today, I'm going to tell you a story about somebody who had to have something to protect him. This little boy's name was Jonathan, and he was inside on a rainy day. It was pouring down with rain. Thankfully, it's the dry season here, so we don't have to deal with the rain anymore. But, oh, did it rain a little bit yesterday? Oh, man. So this person, Jonathan, wanted to go out for a play outside, and his mum said to him, Jonathan, you know you can't go outside if it's raining. You're going to have something to protect your head and your body. He needed to get his raincoat and his rain boots and his rain hat, and he found his rain boots. Everybody pretend you're Jonathan. Put your rain boots on. There we go. And he found his raincoat, and he put his raincoat on. Put your raincoat on. Beautiful. But he couldn't find his rain hat. He said, Mum, I can't find my rain hat. What am I going to do? And she said, well, you can't go outside if you don't have your rain hat. So you're just going to have to stay inside. Well, Jonathan wasn't very happy about this, not one bit. He was like, no, I have to go outside. So he got creative. He found the biggest piece of paper he could find, and I'll show you what he did. You ready? Okay, I need someone to be Jonathan. Come on. Okay, so Jonathan thought he was pretty clever. Can you stand up on the stage for me? That'd be great. Jonathan thought he was pretty clever. He's like, Mum, I've done it. I've got myself a hat. He made it super big, so he was super protected. And Mum said, oh, it's not really going to protect you from the rain, but I'll let you go because you've been so creative. So out he went outside, went out into the rain, and actually by then the rain had sort of stopped, so he was pretty happy about that. And he was playing outside. You're doing such a wonderful job. He was playing outside. He was having a marvelous time when all of a sudden he heard a sound. Wee-oo, 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 wee-oo. Oh, who was it, do you think? It wasn't the police. It wasn't the ambulance. It was the fire people. The firefighters had come, and Jonathan was a very inquisitive young man, so he went running off to see what it was. The fire truck stopped right at a tree. And right at the top of the tree, look up at the tree. Right at the top of the tree. Can you see what that is up there? It's going meow, meow, meow. Oh, it's a cat. There was a cat right at the tree and it couldn't get down, and so the fire people had come to help it. But the fireman came over and he said, excuse me, young man, we've been trying to get up to get this, but we can't get there because we're so big. We need someone little to get up there. Jonathan was super excited. He was like, pick me. I totally want to go up there. So they said, look, young man, you can go up there, but you got to have some protection for your head. And so he thought, I reckon I can do something about that. Can I have your hat? That's the one. He took his hat and he made it into a fireman's hat. And the guy said, yep, you got it. You're protected. You can go up and get the cat. And so he did. He climbed up the ladder. He got the cat and he came down. He was so proud of himself. And off he went on his day. Now, remember it had been raining earlier on in the day. He thought, you know what? I'm starting to get a little bit bored out here. I think I might play in the puddles. And so he decided that he was going to make himself into a pirate so that he could sail the puddles and get all the treasure. And so he took his hat off and
square it the other way. That's the way.
Okay. And so Jonathan became a pirate and he sailed the seven seas. But what does every good pirate need? A boat. They need a boat. Where's your boat? Well, give me the hat. We'll make you a boat. Can I have the hat? Okay.
I thought I wasn't going to get the hat there for a second. Okay.
Here's your boat. Because a good pirate knows that they need to be protected from the seas. Invisible hat now. In their boat. They need a boat to protect them. Now, he was playing around with his boat, but you know what happens to water? To paper when it's been in water, don't you? It starts to, crumble and soak. And so by this time, because he'd been playing in the water for quite some time, the boat started to get wrecked. Thankfully, right about that time, Mum called, "Jonathan, oh, Jonathan, it's time to come inside. You've been outside for a very long time. Come on in." So Jonathan came inside and he brought his little piece of paper with him. He was like, "Mum, I've had the most amazing day today." You can sit on down here if you like. "I've had the most amazing day today. I used my hat to protect me from the rain, and then I used my hat to protect me when I was a fireman, and then I used my hat to protect me when I was a pirate, and then I had my boat to protect me from the seven seas. It's been such a busy day." And Mum, while she was sitting there, she just happened to be playing with the piece of paper. And as she did, she noticed that the piece of paper had actually made a very interesting shape. What does that look like to you? Like a cross? Like a cross? Like an X? Yeah, a little bit like an X, but like a cross. And Mum said, "Wow, would you look at that? All those things that have protected you today are just like how Jesus protects you because he died on the cross. What does Jesus protect us from? From Satan, and he protects us. When he died on the cross, he gave his blood for us, and it protects us. So everywhere we go, if we wear the cross with us, it will protect us, just like Jonathan was protected with all of his different hats. We can wear Jesus and he can protect us." So I want you to think about that next time you're outside playing, or even inside playing, that no matter what you're doing, Jesus' protective blood is covering you. You can go back to your seats. All right. Thank you so much. It's actually time for us to have a special item, and Ema's going to come up and present the special item. I do hope that you enjoy it, and I hope that you will give her all the attention because it'll be her last time doing this with us. So thanks, Ema.
Song I'm going to sing today, it's called "Keep Me in Your Will." Most of the times when we make decisions and we make plans and we think that we could do things by ourselves, but this song, I just want to remind us that it's only that God's will that will keep things going for you. So please just listen to the lyrics in this song. Open your heart and your mind. And pray that the Holy Spirit will help us. Thank you.
not my will, but yours be done. Though I don't understand, the best laid plans are made. Somehow always go astray.
We're certainly going to miss Emma, especially at Malek Church, when she comes around, whenever she's with the family. And she also graces us with special items like that. So we want to say thank you to Emma. Now, those who are right-handed, can you put your hands up? Right-handed? Okay, keep them up there. Those who are left-handed, put your hand up. Okay? What about those right hand? Keep the hands up. Okay. Now I want you to direct those hands to the place where you have your tithes and offerings. Because the deacons are going to come out and collect all of them. Thank you.
Thank you.
you may find a place as we seek the Lord in prayer. Kneel with me. Mighty God and gracious eternal Father, seated on the Most High, from everlasting to everlasting, your love reigns forever. This morning, O Lord, we come to you because we acknowledge that we are but sinners saved by grace, to say thank you for your goodness, your mercy, and your tender loving care. We want to say thank you for the many blessings that you bestowed upon us unbiasedly these past 6 days. We want to say thank you, Father, for who you are and what you are in our lives. We want to say thank you for your Holy Spirit that granted us your presence each day of our lives these past 6 days. We want to say thank you for your holy angels that surrounded us and kept the enemies at bay while we walked this earth these past 6 days. But above all, Father, we just want to say thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. This morning, O Lord, we cry unto you for a fresh unction of your love. Father, you know that if only kept and left to us, our evil thoughts and our evil deeds will only bring us eternal destructions. Therefore, we cry unto you, O Lord, this morning. Forgive us from all our unrighteousness and grant us your grace and mercy and bring us closer so that we can continue to dwell and bask in your presence. Father, this morning we also bring to you our tithes and offerings, and we ask, O Lord, that you will bless this for the furtherance of your work. And we also ask, Father, that you will also grant us the grace in our lives as we go forward, as we offer our lives to you. Father, there are those who are behind prison doors, those in hospital beds, those at home who are sick, but we don't know what's happening to them, but you know, and we commit them to you. We ask, O Lord, that you will give them that peace that passes all understanding and grant us the grace to move forward and comfort us as we go through this life. Thank you, Father, for everything. Thank you that we serve a God that even before we ask, you've already answered. For while we are yet speaking, you've heard our cries. And this morning we ask that as we venture into this Sabbath hour and as we venture into the divine service, we pray that you will be with Pastor Darren. Give him back the remembrance of the things that you blessed him with, so that when we leave this place, we'll know that we have sat at your feet. Father, we ask that you will grant us, each of us, a place so that we will know, Father, that at the end of all this, we have come to you and you have accepted us, because we know that your love is forever fruitful to us. Father, we ask that you will find our worship acceptable in thy sight, because we ask all these things in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Thank you, Dickens. Now, I won't be singing, but I'll ask the person who's going to come and give us a special item. Thank you. God bless.
Hey, Sabbath to you all. Imai and I had always talked about singing together, but that did not happen here. But it is my prayer that may God keep you and Miti safe. And if we don't get a chance to sing together here on earth, we may make it to heaven and sing in that big, great choir. But for the time while we're still here on earth, may God keep us safe and let us commit our lives to Him and all that we have, because He's the only reason that we live today.
But if I lose it all, I am left with nothing. But if I have the Lord, I know I'll make it through. He's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live. Oh, what a reason. You see, there's nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason. You may have tried a lot of things to find real happiness, but if you've looked very long, you know it can't be found. Until you found the Lord in the power of His Spirit, of His Holy Spirit, He'll be the reason to live, and He'll never let you die. He's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason. You see, there's nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason. You see, there's nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason.
Everybody. I have to say it is awesome to see all of your smiling faces today. COVID has been a major interrupter, and to see our three congregations here this morning is just fantastic. And I've been so blessed by the music. I'd much prefer, if you're happy, I'll just sit down and you keep doing that. Thank you to all of our musicians and those who have brought us that music this morning. It's just lifted my soul and really spoken to me. So thanks for using your talents. Do you mind if I get a picture of you all? Because I put out this little video thing every now and again and just share with people where I've been travelling to and all the rest. And you're such a beautiful bunch of people. I'd like to capture it. So, all right, smile or do whatever you do. Here we go. Thank you very much. I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues here this morning as well. It's always a little daunting to be standing in front of very capable pastoral friends. But Pastor Asava, thank you for your invitation to come today. I don't know whether you realise, but Pastor Asava is one of seven of our pastors out of 450 or so ministers across Australia who are currently serving as chaplains to the Defence Force. And that contribution he has one day a week, we're immensely proud of him for getting into that space, because I believe that as Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we have something to offer people everywhere across this country, including our Defence Forces. And so out of those seven pastors that work in defence chaplaincy across the country, the Northern Australian Conference has two. They have Pastor Asava here in the Navy in Darwin, and we have Pastor Rungoso Tungaloa in Townsville with the Air Force. And so we're very proud of our pastors and moving into this chaplaincy space. It's really exciting. And what is really rewarding too is that the Defence Forces, because we're only new to this, we've only been involved in this chaplaincy the last 2 or 3 years, the Defence Forces are telling us how incredibly high caliber our Adventist chaplains are. And they're incredibly impressed. And so we always knew our pastors were hard workers. We knew they were committed. We knew they loved Jesus, and they weren't afraid to step up and be counted. And that's what the Defence Force is recognising at the moment. And so every new pastor who steps up to become a chaplain in the Defence Force, they're almost saying, "We'll take you right now. Thank you very much," because they have such a good reputation. So I just wanted to let you know that. I want to acknowledge Pastor John Beck, who is here on behalf of the union, based in our patch though. And I've known John ever since I can remember as a little boy, because we grew up in the same place, Esperance in Western Australia. And John has always been a great guy, and we're blessed to have him and his gifts and talents based here in Darwin, but serving the ATSIM populations right through Northern Territory, part of South Australia and WA as well. And then I want to acknowledge one of our newest members to our team, and that's Pastor Sawani. And he's one of three new faces on our team this year. We have another new face in Mount Isa and another one in Mackay. But we kind of had to fight WA for him. They really wanted to keep Sawani, and we put up a pretty good case, and praise God, it went our way, and he and Kristen are here. So I just want to recognise and acknowledge my colleagues this morning. Well, thank you all for coming. And as we get into Scripture this morning, would you just bow your heads with me once again? Heavenly Father, this is your message for your people at this time. And Lord, I don't want to mess it up. So I pray that the words, the thoughts, the expressions will all be yours and not mine. May your Holy Spirit move amongst us. Touch our hearts as required. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me introduce you to my great-grandfather, not that he's alive, but just the memory of him. His name was Ernest Charles Leslie Slade, and he was born in a little tiny place called Cooleman in New South Wales in 1890, and he lived to 1982. And the reason I want to introduce you to him is not for his own particular escapades in life, although he was a great football player, he and his brother Potty. And back then, of course, nobody was paid, so he'd get on his bike and he'd ride 15 miles or 10 miles or whatever it was to play footy and then ride home again. And the one thing that stands out in my mind was he could stand, now I'm talking AFL now, I hope that's okay. I don't understand rugby, being born in Western Australia, but he could stand in the AFL goals at one end of the field and he could kick the footy all the way to his brother who was standing in the centre, who would mark it, and then Potty would turn around and boot it through the goals at the other end of the field. That's pretty impressive. I don't know whether fields back then were smaller than they are today, but you know, I can stand 20 metres out from goal and not get the thing through. So that was part of their sporting prowess. But let me share with you some of the events that happened during the course of his 92 years of life. And I'm being selective here, and you'll see why. But when he was 1 year old, a severe depression hit Australia. When he was 9, 16,000 Australian men headed off to South Africa to fight in the Boer War. 1,000 of them did not return. When he was 11, the Black Death struck Australia, and in Sydney there were over 100 deaths alone. When he was 24, World War I started, and 200,000 Australians became casualties of that war, and 62,000 of them died. It really devastated our economy, our markets, food prices rising, economic hardships, there were workers' strikes, 2 referendums on conscription, school and family life disrupted, and Australians of enemy birth or extraction were herded into internment camps. When he was 29, the Spanish flu came to Australian shores and infected 40% of our population. 15,000 Australians died. I checked a week or two ago just on how many have died from our current pandemic, and it's about 7,500. But in this one, 15,000 died. Now you add that 15,000 to the 62,000 who had died just a couple of years previous in World War I. The reason that this pandemic spread so quickly all those years ago was because it was carried by soldiers returning from the war. So it went right through most countries of the world. And what's interesting is that almost the same playbook was instigated back then as we've seen recently. So maritime quarantine was set up to intercept the returning soldiers and overseas travellers. Infected people were diverted to quarantine camps. And I saw a picture of one in South Queensland, and it was just rows and rows of tents. That was the nature of their quarantine camps back then. Commonwealth Serum Laboratories, which was only just in its infancy at that point in time, developed its first experimental vaccine. They produced 3 million free doses for troops and civilians, and they evaluated it to be partially effective. Didn't stop it altogether, but it made a bit of a dent in it. Each state made their own arrangements for handling and containing outbreaks, including organising their own border controls, closing schools and places of entertainment, and mandating the use of masks. They went through it all 100 years ago. When he was 31, my great-grandfather, Australia experienced 3 years of a severe recession following 2 years of high inflation caused by World War I. When he was 40, the Great Depression came to Australia and lasted for a decade. Unemployment peaked at 32%, with tens of thousands of Australians not having enough to eat and suicide rates skyrocketing. 40,000 men roamed around the country looking for work, and 60,000 people were on what they called sustenance payments, which allowed them to buy the bare minimum of food. When my great-grandfather was 49, World War II started. By its end, there were 100,000 Australian casualties and 35,000 deaths. Staple food items such as meat, butter, sugar, and tea were rationed. Women came into the workforce in a big way. And as in World War I, Australians of enemy birth or extraction were herded into internment camps. The war actually came to Australian soil this time, creating much fear and tension. And you know it better than most because of the history that's here in Darwin. 63 raids or something like that, I think I read, up here in Darwin. Huge. When he was 60, 18,000 Australians went off to fight a war in Korea. When he was 72, the Vietnam War began, which saw 60,000 Australian troops involved. And in that same year, England began testing its nuclear weapons on Australian soil. Then when he was 82, the best event of his life happened because I was born and I got to hang out with him for the last 10 years of his life. Now, I've been a little selective in what I've chosen to record from his 92 years of life. But can you see all the stuff that he endured and that people of his generation went through? And I say that because in contrast to my almost 50 years of life, I've been through nothing. There was a recession we had to have under Paul Keating. There was Y2K. There was the Twin Towers. There was a global financial crisis in 2007. None of that really impacted me greatly, even though it was big news at the time, until a couple of years ago when we get to a pandemic that, like the one my great-grandfather went through, turns global and kills many, many people. And that's probably the biggest thing that I've had to face. And somebody said that for our people who are way younger than me even, the biggest thing they had to face up until the pandemic hit in 2020 was not getting enough likes on something they'd posted online. And when you think about it, we've actually been in an amazingly blessed segment of history. Not all that stuff my great-grandfather had to put up with. We've come after that, and it's been relatively turmoil-free up until a couple of years ago. And yet, as I reflect on what my great-grandfather went through, even what we're experiencing now is nothing compared to the constancy of key global, dramatic, disruptive events that seem to come along almost every decade in his life. And we talk about peace and happiness. And I wonder whether for that generation they ever thought it was going to return. Because they just get over one thing and something else strikes. But even though I believe that my great-grandfather had it way worse than what we're going through now, it doesn't minimize the impact of this global pandemic. And of course, you watch the news, you're aware of it, we've breathed it, we've lived it for the last couple of years. But one of the things that really upsets me about this major disruptive event is the impact it's had on our church families. You see, it's caused a lot of conflicting opinions and confusion about what position to take when responding to our state governments imposing a whole bunch of mandates around this. What do we do with that when mandates and health measures are imposed on us by our state governments? And people in our congregations have been taking different sides over the issue, and I don't mind that at all, that people want to have their own opinion and their perspective on it. But it's the fallout that's created, and the tension and the hostility and the judgment and the suspicion and the argument and the division and the arrogance, all of that stuff is what upsets me. And there's a lot of ideas around what this current pandemic means. Is it the start of end time persecution for God's people? Is it unjustly removing our God-given freedoms? Is it a human devised plot to reduce global population and reset economies? Is it an excuse under the guise of a health emergency to control the population? Is it impinging on our religious liberties? Is it somehow linked to the mark of the beast? And you could go through that list and you could tick where you align yourself, and all of us would tick a different number of boxes. And because we all see this issue differently, we come at it from different perspectives, it has caused tension, it has caused division, it has caused fallout, and it breaks my heart. Because we're God's people. And God prayed for us. and he specifically prayed for unity. And this thing has come along, this menace has come along, and not only is it killing people, but it's creating tremendous disunity in our church family. And my friends, if I can speak from my heart, and I always want to be completely honest with you, this is a small hurdle in a whole bunch of hurdles yet to come. And if we stumble at this hurdle, heaven help us for what's coming down the pipeline. Do you see what I'm saying? And so that's not a rebuke. It's just it's just a conviction I have. Lord, how are we going to get through all the other stuff that we know is coming? Because we read our Bibles, we know it's going to get far worse. People who say, well, we'll just get through the pandemic and everything's going to settle down, go back to normal. We know as Bible students that things are not going to get better. We praise God for these periods of relative peace and safety and security that we have had and that we still experience here. But ultimately, my friends, you and I know that it's going to get worse. That we are going to find ourselves more and more in a position where we are weighing up government mandates and rules and instructions and directives and all that sort of stuff. And we're going to have to make decisions as a church family about what we're going to go along with, what we will accept and what we can't. And in a sense, this pandemic is almost like a dry run of what's to come. Why? Because we were kicked out of our church buildings. And I'm not saying that in a malicious way, but all buildings were closed. So we weren't able to worship in our buildings. We had to figure out how we worship then when we don't have this facility. We were mandated to do a whole bunch of things that some people felt terribly uncomfortable about and had to make a decision on. It's a great rehearsal for the times that are coming when, again, we're going to have to work out what we do with mandates, where we're not going to have access to our buildings and there are going to be restrictions and limitations put on us. And so this morning I'd like to share with you some thoughts that God impressed me with from Scripture about how we deal with times such as these. What do we do? Because most of us have never experienced a global crisis of this nature. And so I'd love to explore with you this morning how we stand in adverse times such as these. And let me just put it on the record straight away, because my sermon is entitled Manhandled and Mandated. And we're looking at Daniel chapter 1. And I just want to say that I do not mind what side of the discussion you are on. I do not mind if you are vax or if you are anti-vax. I don't mind at all. It is your choice. It is your decision. And that doesn't separate you from being my brother, my sister, my companion, heading to the kingdom under the lordship of Jesus Christ. It doesn't make a difference to me. And I respect you for the choice you've made. I've sat down with people who have wrestled with the decisions around these mandates, and whether they've gone one way or the other, they have had very good reasons for doing so. And had I been in their shoes, I would have made the same decision. Either way. And it doesn't just impact our church families, it impacts our own families. My own family wrestles with this because my brother chose not to get vaccinated and lost his job as a teacher. Whereas other members of my family have had the vaccination and have been able to carry on. And it's caused my brother a huge amount of stress as he's stood to the convictions that he's had. But I love him and I respect him for that, and I will support him 100% in those convictions. It's not breaking my family and my friends. This stuff shouldn't break our church family either. Let's not give Satan the victory to use this pandemic as a way to decimate us, divide us, and just have us all factionalized and off griping about one another and doing our own thing. So take your Bibles this morning. Turn with me to the book of Daniel. As we have a look at the first 16 verses in Daniel and see if there are some lessons that Scripture can give us, some guidelines about how we are to be in a crisis such as this. Now, there's lots in Scripture that can speak to it, but I just want to deal with one passage. And so Daniel chapter 1, and it starts this way, verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasure house of his God. So it says there that there were two specific things that when the Babylonian king came across and invaded Judah that he carried off. And there's a whole bunch of history behind this we don't have the time to explore, but fascinating nonetheless about Jehoiakim and what a dodgy individual he was and the alliances with Egypt and then Babylon and all the rest. But as a result of Jehoiakim's behavior, Nebuchadnezzar heads across there and says, I'm going to sort this fella out. And so he takes him and he carts him back to Babylon, and he carts all the treasures back to Babylon as well. It's a handy thing to take to fund your military campaign. What it doesn't tell us was taken back to Babylon was a whole bunch of the nobility. But we know it's true because as we keep reading, it'll become clear. Verse 3. Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his eunuchs, to bring in some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and literature of the Babylonians. Now, I don't know whether you've just read that, but the criteria for these guys is pretty high. You know, handsome, well, good aptitude, all the rest. That counts me out on both counts. Clearly, these young fellows were standouts. And so there they are being rounded up to serve the king. Verse 5, the king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. They were to be trained for 3 years, and after that they were to enter the king's service. Among these were some from Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The chief official gave them new names, to Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, to Azariah Abednego. All right, now this is the key part of the story, and the next bit's really exciting, but we'll get to that temporarily. If you just permit me some time to unpack this for a minute, because what we find here is a story of some of these boys that have been taken from their home country, their country of origin, and this was a common practice back then, and what it did was it ensured the good behavior of those left behind. Because when all of your children, these key young people, are taken and they're under the thumb of the conquering king, you think twice about whether you want to rebel. Because your kids' lives are at stake. And so it was a control measure. But what we find here in these few verses, as I read it, are actually five mandates that Daniel and his three friends are facing thanks to the efforts of Nebuchadnezzar. And I want to alert you to what these five mandates are. The first mandate that they are facing is a forced removal mandate. Pretty clear. And I don't know how much say Daniel and his friends had with some of these mandates. We're a bit blessed here in this country. mostly we have a bit of a choice. Now, some of those choices, like with my brother, comes with pretty severe economic consequences to him personally, but he still has a choice. Nobody is holding my brother down and forcing a needle into his arm, praise God. So he has a choice, even though that choice has cost him his job. And in a sense, Daniel and his three friends were in a bit of a privileged slash conflicted situation like we are here in Australia. On the one hand, the king is hosting them. He's taking care of their needs, and they probably are living a somewhat privileged lifestyle being under the caretakership of the king in the palace. And yet they're still struggling with a whole bunch of pretty severe mandates. Same here in our country. Compared to other places around the globe, we're doing okay, folks. We're doing more than okay. And a lot of the stuff we whinge and complain about are first world problems. And yes, it's a pain in the neck to have some of these mandates and the disruptions it's caused to work and to life and to ministry and what God's called us to do are frustrating. And yet as Australians living in this country, we are still pretty privileged compared to other countries. So Daniel and his friends are kind of in that same setting, but they've got a forced removal mandate here where they're taken prisoner, they're marched 1,500 kilometres because they didn't put them all in buses, they walked these guys all chained together from Jerusalem to Babylon, and they tell us that these marches were more like death marches where only a third of the captives who started actually made it to the destination. So Daniel and his three friends would have experienced a lot of trauma on the road, a lot of deaths of their friends, and they were strong enough to survive that grueling march, and they made it to Babylon. And the other tragedy of this mandate is they were most likely never to see their family and all those they left behind in Jerusalem ever again. And if you go to Ezra and you read the lists, there were two groups of captives 70 years later who left Babylon, two groups at different times, and went back to Jerusalem. And you won't find Daniel or his friends' names listed in the captive list there. They never did go back. And I don't know about you, but if someone was to yank me away from everything that I knew and loved and stick me in a foreign place never to return, that'd be pretty rough. That's the first mandate. The second mandate is a eunuch mandate. And you might be scratching your heads because you haven't heard about this one, so let me elaborate. Ashpenaz, according to my Bible, has a title, chief of the eunuchs. Some versions say court official. But the Hebrew word is talking clearly about eunuchs. Daniel and his friends are placed under the care of the bloke who cares for eunuchs. Okay? That's still thin ice, and I get that. So let me elaborate a little further. It was a common practice historically for this to happen. I don't know whether it's because there were a lot of queens and concubines in the palace or what the reason was that they chose to do this, but they did. So how do we know, apart from the fact that Ashpenaz is looking after Daniel and his friends, how do we know that this was a mandate they had to endure? Well, there's a text in Isaiah chapter 39 and verse 7, and I'll give you a little bit of history. This is about Hezekiah, and you remember he was going to die. And he turned his face to the wall and he prayed to God, and God heard his prayer and said, okay, I'll give you another how many years? 15 years. And he said, how do I know that you're going to give me those 15 years? And God said, do you want the sundial to go forward or do you want it to go backward 10 steps? And he said, put it backward 10 steps. So God did the impossible. And he turned the sun back. Well, the Babylonians, who are big into astronomy, noticed this incredible solar event. It doesn't happen. And they connected it to this miraculous healing of the king over there. And they sent a delegation across to find out what was going on. Hezekiah was so overjoyed to be getting attention from the big boys that he forgot all about to thanking God and giving all the glory to God. And all he did was parade these fellows around his kingdom and show them all his treasure and all the cool stuff he's got and everything. And he basically didn't share God's miraculous power and healing with them at all. And Isaiah comes back to him and says, I cannot believe you did that. And then he gives him these words in Isaiah chapter 39 and verse 7. He said, the time will surely come when everything in your palace and all that your fathers have stored up until this day will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left, says the Lord. And some of your descendants, your own flesh and blood, who will be born to you, will be taken away, and they will become eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. And what we read here in Daniel chapter 1 is a direct fulfillment of what Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, told Hezekiah those generations before. All the treasures in his storehouses that he showed them were carted off to Babylon, and their young men would become eunuchs in the palace as well. Now, out of all mandates as a male, I find this one the most offensive. But nonetheless, that was mandate number two. Mandate number three, an education mandate. 3 years studying in the Babylonian university. The Babylonians were actually a very educated people. Both men and women were taught to read and write. Almost all towns had libraries in there. And so if you're going to serve the king, you've got to be educated another step above the population. And the Babylonians were big on their education and they did some amazing stuff. In fact, we've got a lot to thank the Babylonians for. Maybe a few things to curse them for as well. But for instance, if you look at your watch and you'll notice there that you've got 12 hours, but those hours are divided into 60 minutes. And yes, each minute's divided into 60 seconds. That all comes from the Babylonians. They had a base six numbering system, which is why we've got the sixes and the sixes. 360 degrees in a circle comes from the Babylonians. They are big on all this stuff. That's where we get it. You can thank them or you can curse them. But you go, how come we work in a base 10 system here with decimal currency and we're working on 60 minutes in an hour? That's the Babylonians. And when the Bible talks about 666, for the reader of Scripture back in the day, they clearly understood all the pagan roots, the Babylonian astrological stuff and all the rest. Their priests used to wander around with amulets that had all the numbers, and you add all the rows of those numbers up on the little amulet, it added up to 666. They had a base six numbering system. And so there's actually a lot in this, but in for Daniel and his friends, during their time in Babylon, the focus was on mathematics, philosophy, astronomy, and astrology, which included magic and omens. And we know they were big on this because when you get into Daniel chapter 2 and Nebuchadnezzar has a dream he can't recall, who's the first people he calls in? Astrologers, magicians, soothsayers, all of these guys. And so while most of that university education is not unpalatable, having to study that stuff when you worship the God of heaven would have been pretty obnoxious. But that's the education mandate that was enforced on them, imposed on them. The fourth mandate is a name change mandate. And this one you might think is quite mild, but it's still an offensive one to these Jewish boys whose names reflect their God and aspects or attributes of the God that they serve. Those beautiful names are taken away and replaced with pagan names that kind of connect with their gods. It's a great way to erase somebody's identity. You take away their culture, you take away their heritage, you give them other names, you put them in a completely foreign place with different education and all the rest. That's how you erase their heritage. But you might have been able to take the boys out of their culture, but you couldn't take their culture out of the boys. And that's what I love about Daniel and his friends. They stood true to their God in spite of all of these mandates that they're enduring. Now, Daniel and his friends weren't the only ones that when they served in a king's court were given a different name. Because Joseph, when he went through his experiences all down through into Egypt and ended up then becoming Pharaoh's prime minister, was given another name by Pharaoh, which was his official prime minister name. Do you remember what it was? An Egyptian name, Ashpenaz Paneah. That was him. Do you remember Queen Esther when she served in the court of Xerxes? Esther was not her original Hebrew name. What was it? Hadassah. So we find this in Scripture, and it was no different for Daniel and his friend. But Nebuchadnezzar says, I don't want to be naming you blokes those crazy names that I can't pronounce. I want to give you something that I can. It's like when I meet somebody from overseas, and some names from different countries are really hard. They're really different. And often when people come and they move to Australia or whatever, they'll take on a simple name like Jack. It's great, I can pronounce it. Maybe that was Nebuchadnezzar's issue, or he just wanted, because they were serving him, he wanted to give them the authority that would come if they had Babylonian names. So that's the fourth mandate. The fifth mandate that we've read there is the prescribed diet mandate, where it is very clearly given to them, this is the food you're going to eat, guys. And to be honest, it was the best food available in the country. Well, they thought it was. It was certainly the best quality, in the sense it was prepared for the king himself, and they were to eat that food. Under normal circumstances, anyone would have jumped at accepting that mandate. And in a sense, it's a little bit of a surprise, because out of the five mandates, this one Daniel has a different attitude to, and I want you to notice what it says there in verse 8. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in this way. Now God had caused the official to show favour and sympathy to Daniel, but the official told Daniel, I'm afraid of my lord the king who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other young men your age? The king would then have my head be hooked because of you. So out of all the mandates that Daniel was facing, this one he said, it's a line I will not cross. And this is really useful for us, because it's the same today. We've had a whole pile of mandates come on us, and some of us are saying, hang on a second, that one I can live with, but not this one. And that was what Daniel was doing. Out of the five, he says, this is a line I won't cross. It says Daniel resolved that he was not going to defile himself this way. And for those of you who are good Bible students and understand the Hebrew dietary laws and all the rest, you'll gain an insight into some of the reasons why Daniel said, nah, not doing this. What I like about Daniel is he doesn't go in trying to seek an exemption. He doesn't go and rally all the Hebrew captives and try and get them on the same page and do sit-ins or sit-outs or whatever. He finds that there are three other Hebrew boys who have the same convictions as him, and together they go seeking an exemption from the diet mandate. And the first thing they do is go to the boss. And their boss is Ashpenaz, chief of the eunuchs. And so they go to him, and you'll notice the manner in which Daniel goes to him. And it is polite, it is courteous, and it is respectful. He doesn't get in Ashpenaz's face. And I say this because I've bumped into some people who have taken a position in this pandemic. But man, they almost want to shirt front me to convince me that their position is correct. Do you know what I mean? They're bordering on obnoxious. They're in my face. They're in other people's face. They've got their decision. They've made. They're following their convictions, but they're trying to enforce their decision, their conviction, on everybody else. If I'm vaccinated, that's my decision, not yours. And it's not your obligation to follow. If I'm unvaccinated, that's my conviction, my decision. It's not for me to stick that on you. Do you understand? So what I love about Daniel's example, and this is good for us to take away, because as we see more mandates come down the pipeline, and they are coming, we know that. Scripture tells us what some of them are. As we see them, we have to make a decision for ourselves. All of Daniel's compatriots didn't line up and say, we're with you, brother, lead the charge, we're all behind you. Out of all of the nobility that were taken captive, only four decided this was a line they wouldn't cross. Now, I'm not judging the other guys, because I don't know how they made it work. It's possible to go and eat at the king's table and to pick the kind of foods that you want, like we do at a church lunch. You know, some people have got intolerances to different foods and all the rest. Do they eat them just because they're on the table? No. Some people are on a bit of a health kick at the moment, like I should be, you know, and they're not eating this and they're not eating that, and they're just going for the leafy stuff. Good on you. You go and you pick and you take what you want. Now, did the other guys do that at the king's table? I don't know. But Daniel and his friends said, no, we want an exemption from that general diet in its entirety, and we want to go a different way. So they go and they politely ask the boss and say, could you give us an exemption? Now, Ashpenaz is a meat and potatoes kind of guy. And he says, anybody who wants to eat rabbit food after is going to look terrible and the king's going to have my head because of it. He can't fathom it. Now, you probably met people who are vegan. And some of them kind of a bad representative of their diet. They're gaunt, they're pasty, they look unhappy, and they're trying to convince me to eat the same diet. And I go, really? Now, not everybody's like that. I'm generalizing because my wife is vegan and she's gorgeous. That's why I married her. But Ashpenaz, he's your meat and veg kind of guy, and he says anybody who doesn't have my kind of diet can't look good, they can't remain healthy. And we see that prevailing attitude around today, don't we? Although it's not as strong as it used to be, but people who just can't fathom that you could go without meat and you could go without rich foods and that somehow you would survive or even maintain some degree of health. But Daniel and his friends knew because they knew what God's diet was. And so they were confident. But as much as God inclines this guy to like these boys, and it says that he did, as much as he likes them, he has to decline the exemption request. Because he says, I'm not going to risk my job and my head on you guys heading down that pathway. So what does Daniel and his friends do? It's still their conviction. And I imagine, like they did in chapter 2, where you find a death mandate on them, I imagine that they were very prayerful in this. We see them prayerful in chapter 2 with a death mandate. And God gave them an idea. They tried a different strategy. Notice what it is. Verse 11, Daniel then said to the guard, whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you see. So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the raw food. So the guard took away their choice food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. If a door closes, prayerfully seek a creative way to open another one. That's what Daniel and his friends did as they sought an exemption to this mandate. They went about finding, not a loophole, although they're good to find if you can. Every time a mandate has come through from either the Northern Territory government or the Queensland government, I have read every word of that thing. Trying to find if somehow we don't have to fit into a clause or if there's some workaround or can we just do this instead of this. Every one I've read to try and see what our obligations are. And is there some way we can continue doing ministry without having to jump through all the hoops? Haven't had much success, mind you, but it doesn't stop me trying. But here, Daniel and his friends, they come up with another idea, and that is, let's just talk to our guard. And a 10-day trial is not a high risk. You see, Ashpenaz said, what you guys want to do is high risk, because they just went to him with a blanket, give us an exemption and just feed us this. And he said, no way. But what they're doing with the guard is they're not asking the guard the same thing. They're changing the terms. They're saying, could you just give us a test? And the guard, who's probably a meat and potatoes kind of guy as well, can't see that there's going to be any significant deterioration in the appearance of these boys after only 10 days. Now, Daniel and his friends know it's going to be the opposite. When people do detoxes, how long do they normally last? Week to 10 days? I haven't done one recently, so I'm not exactly an authority, but my wife doesn't. Essentially what they're doing is a bit of a detox. Now, you know what happens when you go on this kind of a diet as a detox. Your face gets more colour in it, your eyes get brighter, your skin takes on a really good hue. That's what happens when you just eat 100% nutritious stuff for a prolonged period and you don't supplement it with processed foods and with a lot of sugar and a lot of salts and oil and stuff like that. You actually start to radiate. So Daniel and his friends knew what they were doing. And of course, God led the process. And at the end of that 10-day detox, guess what? They looked so good that the guard said, okay, you fellas, my job's not at risk. Go for it. And they got their exemption. And I just love this story of Daniel because it gives us a whole bunch of mandates. And it gives us Daniel pushing back on one of those mandates and the process he went through to get an exemption. And I think that there are lessons we can take from this as we take every mandate that comes our way and assess whether we should go for it or not. You know, I've heard some folk use the slippery slope reasoning for standing against some of these mandates today. When the mask mandate was in Queensland, I was visiting churches. This is the early part of the year, so I was starting to get back out there. And I look out, and a third of people, maybe even a half of people, were not wearing masks. Now, I'll grant that there are some people who medically can't wear them. There's always those exceptions. But what was happening was some of our folk were going, I don't agree with this vaccine. And so in order, they kind of throw the baby out with the bathwater. So they weren't worried about social distancing. They were ignoring the mask thing. They weren't, doing the hand sanitizing thing. They just threw the whole lot out because in their minds it was a slippery slope. If I give in to wearing a mask, then the next thing I'm going to be doing this and I'm going to be doing this and then I'm going to be getting a vaccine and then I'm going to be saying yes to the mark of the beast. That's the slippery slope argument. It starts here and ends here. And I'd like to suggest to you that I don't think it's a valid way of us approaching the mandates that are both here and to come. Where the slippery slope argument works is for addiction. Now, I got to admit to you, I love sugar. And I got to hang out with our Fijian folk last night over at the hall here, and and boy, oh boy, that cheesecake was just marvellous. Loved it. My wife would say I have a problem with it. So if you were to give me a block of chocolate, a family-sized block of chocolate, then I'd just knock that off and I'd go looking for another one. My wife, if you gave her a block of vegan chocolate, will take one square and leave the rest of it in the fridge for 3 months until it passes its expiry date and I throw it out. Now, I'd do the same with vegan chocolate personally because it doesn't taste the same, but that's beside the point. So she would say to me, honey, just have one piece. I can't. It's not the way it works. If you start me with sugar, I'm going to finish the job and I'm going to do it to the best of my ability. And so the slippery slope for me with my addiction, that sounds hard. I don't want to say my name's Darren Slade and I've got an addiction, but my wife says I do, so I'll own it. If the slippery slope argument works for me with my addiction. So if I want to behave myself when it comes to sugar, then I just got to cut it out. Don't just give me one piece. Otherwise, I'm going to take the block. Okay. So I understand it in those terms. But when it comes to the mandates, we don't find Daniel using a slippery slope argument. We find that four of them were accepted, and I'll wear the rebuttal that he probably didn't have a lot of choice. I understand that. But he took four of these, and he pushed back on one. He assessed each one as far as he had the ability to, because it was an autocratic government. He assessed each one on its own merits. And so I would like to suggest to you this morning, this afternoon, as we assess the mandates that are coming our way, prayerfully consider each one on its own merits and ask God what you should do. Now, that might sound overly simplistic to those who have dived into YouTube and in the online world and said, I'm smart enough, smarter than all the medical practitioners out there. I can get to the bottom of this and I can make a decision. And I've met people like that. They think they've solved the problem where we've got people on both sides of the argument with a string of letters after their name this long who can't agree, but they know. And it gets awfully confusing when you get online and you try and get to the bottom of it and you find all of these credible people arguing polar opposite opinions. But I want to tell you something that shouldn't be a secret to you. And that is that you and I follow a God who is the way, the truth, and the life. And as my ultimate source of truth, God knows what the reality is with these current mandates. And he knows whether that stuff in that syringe is good for me or not. He knows whether it's going to adversely affect me or not. He knows whether I need it and he needs to negate the side effects of it to continue doing ministry or not. So I'm just going to skip through all the rubbish and the nonsense that's online out there and all the conflicting and the contradictory information, and I'm simply going to ask my God, who knows everything about everything and who knows all the dodgy discussions in darkened rooms and all of the secret plots and the conspiracies and everything, he knows all of that and he can tell me which way I should go. And in case you don't think that's the right way to go and it's too simplistic, let me read you a couple of texts that we should claim as Christians. Isaiah chapter 30. This is what it says. I'm going to read you one from the Old Testament and one from the New Testament. Isaiah chapter 30. Chapter 30, verse 21. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, "This is the way, walk ye in it." I go to God with each one of these mandates that come and I say, "Lord, what should I do?" And he tells me, go to the left or to the right. That's the beauty we have as Seventh-day Adventist Christians of being able to ask the ultimate authority, the arbiter of all truth, which way we should go. And he says, "I will guide and lead you." Nobody else has that luxury except those who follow Jesus. And here we are, sometimes arguing with each other, and I've had so many people text me stuff, pro this, anti this, trying to justify their position. Read this, this is the truth. And then you read it, and then the next article debunks that completely, and you go, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm not going to waste my time, because all I have to do is ask God, and he will tell me whether to go to the left or to the right. I am not oversimplifying this. Folks, as Christians, we have that luxury. We have that service. We have God who is willing to do this for us. So in this time with so much confusion and tension and heartache and turmoil, let's use it for goodness sake. And then let me give you a passage in the New Testament as well, James chapter 1. There's plenty of promises around this. James chapter 1 and verse 5 says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him." And folks, I've got to tell you, when it comes to this pandemic and all these mandates and all the stuff swirling around it, I lack wisdom. And the more I read, the more I realize I don't know much. But I serve a God who's got all the wisdom and promises to give me some of it. That voice is behind you and me to tell us which way to go. That same voice that was behind Daniel and his friends is telling us which way to go today with our mandates, just like he was telling Daniel which way to go with his mandates. We can trust him. I got to tell you, folks, these mandates frustrate me immensely. I don't like what it's done to our church congregations. I don't like what it's done to our mission initiatives and momentum. I don't like what it's done even to our team. We've lost some of our folk in our team because of it. But I trust God. And every time an obstacle comes up, he makes a way. And so as I wrap up today, because I recognize our time is gone, I want to share with you four takeaways. Four takeaways from Daniel chapter 1. The first one is this: God's promises of guidance and wisdom are for us to claim in this hour. Each time a new mandate comes against us, check it in with God and listen to the guiding of his Holy Spirit on which way you should go. Either accept it or reject it. And as a tagline to that, let me add, and don't judge the person next to you who God might be prompting in a different direction. It's not for us to judge. Daniel didn't try and get all of his fellow compatriots on board. He did what was right in his eyes as he felt God's conviction leading him. You do what's right for you as you feel God's leading you, and you let the next person be led by God in their own convictions. Let's stop judging and fighting over this, folks. There's way bigger things at play. So that's number one. Number two, he doesn't shield us from these times of trial, but is with us in them. Notice Daniel and his friends, they went through four mandates and God only delivered them from one. God was with them in those mandates. And it's easy for us to look to Daniel and say, oh, you know, praise God, you know, Daniel stood up and God got him out of it. Yeah, but what about all the rest of that stuff he had to go through? God's with us in the trouble. And Psalm 23 says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. He's with us in the valley, whatever we're going through. Number three, it's the trials and difficulties that shape us into the likeness of Jesus, not successes and victories. And what this is doing, this period that we're living through at the moment, is it's refining us. Some, it's refining for the better. Sadly, some seem to be refining for the worse. Because if you look at the fruitage, it's deeply troubling. But God says in Romans chapter 3, and I won't take time to turn to it, Romans chapter 5, sorry, verse 3, he says that trials produce perseverance, and perseverance produces this, and that produces something else, and so forth. And so these things refine us. And number four, true character is revealed in a time of crisis. Look at how amazing Daniel's character was for such a young lad, and ask yourself, what character are you and I revealing in this time of crisis? Is it the same as Daniel's? That is, calm, polite, kind, prayerful, unshakable, faith-filled? Or is it like some people that have come across my path, critical, rebellious, argumentative, and judgmental? What character are you revealing in this time of crisis? Because that character will indicate who you're connected to or not. And we're God's people. And the greatest advertisement we are for Jesus is how we treat one another. So as I wrap up, I want you to ponder what God's trying to tell you there from Daniel chapter 1. But simply to say, there's more coming, folks. It doesn't need to scare us. It doesn't need to guilt us, because God is in control and he promises to get us through to a safe harbor. He's building a place for us in heaven. It's locked in. Don't panic, but just ask God at every step, what do I do here? And in the meantime, instead of us fighting and arguing with one another about vaccination or any other related issue, we've got a work to do to tell people about Jesus. And so let's do what God convicts us, share him with others faithfully until he comes, because they need to hear about him. May God bless you as you contemplate his word today.
Praise the Lord for the message. As we prepare to leave and reflect on the message, may our prayer be that God lead us. Let's stand together and sing our hymn, He Leadeth Me.
Oh,
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your leading in our lives. We've sung about it. We thank you for all your promises around this, and we trust you, Lord, as we move into an uncertain future, that you can make it certain for us through your leadership. Thank you that we have nothing to fear, but that you've gone before us. You've offered us all the power, all the guidance, everything that we need, Lord, to come safely through to that home you're preparing for us in heaven. We look forward to that day, Lord, and we trust you in the meantime. Would you bless every head bowed here, I pray. You know the secret desires of their hearts, Lord, the things that only you know that are between you and them. Would you just help them through the struggles, the difficulties, and the challenges that each one faces, I pray. Lord, fill each of us with your Holy Spirit again today. Guide us and lead us as you have promised. And thank you in advance for what you're doing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.